You're listening to Oh My Health, There Is Hope podcast.
When your heart is aching and your world is shaking, don't give up. No, no, don't give up.
Hello and welcome to Oh My Health, There Is Hope, the podcast. I'm your host, Gianna Short, and today we're here with Dr. Allison Gottschalk. Dr. Gottschalk is a naturopathic doctor focused on PCOS and women's hormonal health. She is modernizing the way in which we treat female hormone concerns through education, empowerment, and mentorship. I am so glad you're here today because I just was educated on what PCOS even was.
Yeah, so, okay.
There's a lot of people out there who are like, what is that?
Yeah. A lot of confusion and a lot of misinformation out there about that concern. For sure.
Well, welcome to the show. And one of the first things we always ask our guests is if they will share a story of hope with us, because I believe our stories of hope literally go out and create change in the world, like maybe a ripple effect we don't even see.
Okay. Yeah. And I'd love to. So my big story of hope would probably be delivering the message that there are more treatment options available to women who have hormone concerns that they're probably not even made aware of. So starting off with my personal story of, you know, how I got into working with women and hormones, PCOS, began in my second year of medical school, where I was a hot mess, stressed out, burnt out, not feeling like myself. At this point, I had been on the birth control pill for like 10 plus years off and on again, and wondering if I should, you know, go off of it for a little bit, see how my hormones are doing and whatnot, because I originally had gone on it for cystic acne, irregular cycles. And just, it seemed like the thing to do back in the day. You know, everybody was handed a prescription for the birth control pill. So in my second year medical school, I went off of the pill, and shortly after my cystic acne came back, my irregular cycles, my hormones were a mess. I gained about 20 pounds, which was unusual for me, being very athletic most of my life. And I was just confused and lost about what was going on. It wasn't until, you know, a couple of years after, where I really educated myself about hormones, what they're doing, what the pill, you know, does within the body, and how we can treat the root cause of hormone concerns. Because I didn't want to be using that Band-Aid approach long-term to correct for some of those symptoms when I had the resources to really get to that root cause. So my big lesson or message of hope would just be knowing that there are more options out there if you're feeling confused about your health, about your hormones. And there's people out there like myself who would love to help you as well.
So I love that message. One of the things I think is a real sad thing is it seems like women only know about two hormones. And what I keep trying to say, as my daughter does, there are so many hormones and everything is connected to one. So it's crazy that we think like we have, you know, maybe two hormones that function our whole body. And my daughter was trying to list a hormone every week and write about it. And she's like, I literally could do this for years.
Yes. Oh yeah, absolutely. And the confusing thing about that too, or sort of confusing, is how they're all intertwined with each other. So when we see a hormone imbalance with one hormone, we usually can predict that we'll see an imbalance with something else. So for example, your thyroid, so your main metabolism hormone, we often see, you know, in women who have thyroid concerns, issues with your adrenal glands as well. So your stress response glands. So the connection is so strong, and imbalance with one often leads to an imbalance of other, which makes it fascinating work for me to do, but frustrating on the part of the patient for sure.
And it is sometimes hard to narrow down where that root cause is coming from. So because I just learned about what PCOS is, I know I can't be the only one. Like literally, I have two daughters that are doctors. My husband's a doctor and I didn't know who it was.
Okay. Yeah. It's, you know, that's a very common response too when people haven't heard it, you know, like let's hit up Google and figure out what exactly is going on. And when you open up Google and you type in PCOS, so polycystic ovary syndrome, the first thing that will come up is women who have either cysts on their ovaries and they have high male hormones, so testosterone. And that is sort of the gist of it, but there's much more to it. So PCOS is known to be a metabolic concern. So we see issues with glucose and insulin, but also a hormone imbalance concern. So we see elevated testosterone, and in some cases, women not ovulating regularly or having really long cycles. So we're seeing that all imbalance also with estrogen and progesterone with their cycle as well. And the fascinating thing with PCOS is that there are many different subtypes with it, and it can present in many different ways. So some women might notice that they fit the profile of like the basic symptoms. Some of them match up, but not all of them do. So it can present in slightly different ways, which is fascinating. And I think it's an estimated, 1.4 million women in Canada are projected to have PCOS. So it's one of those health concerns that often flies under the radar, and women aren't given the proper treatment or tools to work through it.
I know that, like, I'm way past all that fun stuff, but I do remember, like, I feel like I didn't do back when I was suffering through my monthly cycles and what was going on in between. I don't feel like they did enough study because they figured it's not going to kill you. It's just part of nature, right? So it's not like on our radar to figure out what that is. And now they are, I mean, we're doing some amazing things. And a lot of it's because we have a lot of women doctors now, right? That are like, yeah, I don't want to live like this anymore. So I'm going to figure out what's going on. So I love that we're making huge progress with it. But for PCOS, like, I do know that I feel like it's everybody's got it now. Like you were just saying, like the women in Canada, there's so many people getting it. What do you think is the root cause of it? Is it that we're all at some point on some form of birth control? Is it the foods we're eating? Is a combination of everything?
Yeah, I think there is a combination of a few different factors that are going on. You know, genetics certainly can play a role in terms of, your whole birth story and how that was. But also certainly the foods, you're eating, your whole environment, your stress response. I certainly think it is multifactorial. There's multiple things going on as well. But it's a lot of the main bothersome symptoms. So like having irregular cycles, being concerned that you won't be able to conceive, have a baby when you want to. Those are big reasons for why women come to see us to begin with, because they, similar to me, maybe being on the pill for most of their life, they get off of the pill and they realize that those same symptoms that put them on the pill to begin with reemerge after they come off of it. And then, they're not having regular cycles, and it's all of a sudden this panic to figure out what's going on with this almost this self-imposed timeline, because you want to have a baby within a certain amount of time. So there's a bit of a rush seen with that too. So it's a fascinating concern, and there's so much that we can do to support women through it.
So when you say you're modernizing the way in which we treat female hormone concerns, I want to know more about what that means.
Yes. So typically, how it has been, if you go to see your family doctor with either, PMS concerns, irregular cycles, or even if you're, 55, 60, experiencing hot flashes, menopausal, perimenopause, menopausal symptoms, in both cases, usually the main treatment options we see are either you're handed the birth control pill or you're given an antidepressant, so an SSRI medication in most cases. Not to say that either of those options are bad or, should be shamed in any way. No pill shaming here. But my big problem with this is that oftentimes women are not engaged in the informed consent conversation that should be spoken about at the time of the prescription, because there is so much more that we can offer women aside from just the pill or antidepressant to really get to that root cause. It's my way of modernizing, hormones and the way we work with women and hormones is to really get to that root cause and not just put that Band-aid approach onto it. Figure out, how are your adrenal glands doing? Your stress response? Is there something off with your thyroid? Are you, ovulating regularly? Or do we need to implement, treatments or procedures to kind of get you to ovulate regularly so that you're benefiting from the hormones, estrogen and progesterone, that sort of thing. So it's getting to that root cause, doing the necessary blood work we see fit as necessary. So we're not playing that guessing game, because oftentimes too, when it comes to blood work, women get the bare bones of testing done. You know, it'll be the very basic things, and we don't usually get a lot of information out of that. So, you know, we can't test and treat your thyroid concern if we don't know it exists there to begin with, if we haven't had that full blood work done. So it's getting the proper testing done and then implementing procedures to get to that root cause.
I came from the category or the age group where people were given those two pills, right? If you had problems. And what I'm scared to see now is the young children going in that are 13, 14 years old, and they're coming into their womanhood and they're having a few problems. And what do? They hand them the pill. And I feel like when I was growing up, if you heard of someone who was having problems getting pregnant, that was like unusual to have someone struggling with fertility. And I feel like now every person I talk to is having struggle. They're struggling with fertility. I'm just kind of wondering, maybe that has a little something to do with us putting our 13 and 14 year olds on birth control.
Yeah, there's a lot of questions absolutely to be asked. There may be women are just feeling more comfortable talking about, you know, their fertility journey as well too. Yeah, there's a lot of questions, but I think it's so great that women are feeling comfortable, you know, speaking up more so about their struggles and sharing their story, because it certainly helps others kind of, you know, going through similar situations.
I definitely think you're right. I think women are getting more empowered and they're actually speaking up for themselves, which is amazing. And that is how we create change. One of the things that I did, and I don't know, like I had a lot of problems when I was having my cycle, and I started literally charting it, like my bad days. Like it seemed like it was every other month, which triggered the fact that I was probably having one side problems with one ovary and not both. But it seemed like every other month I was having massive problems, and the other months would go by kind of slow with no problems. But I think charting it for me was super easy to give my doctor and say, these are my symptoms, this is what's happening. But for some reason, it doesn't seem like it's happening every month. It's just like every other month.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's one of the best ways to really tune into your body too, is tracking your cycle, you know, details of it. When is your first day? Are you noticing any spotting? How is the pain? And any other symptoms that you may be experiencing as well, like any breast tenderness leading up to your period, any migraine headaches, because oftentimes we can see headaches, migraines in particular, correspond and correlate to where you are in your cycle. And we attribute that to fluctuations with estrogen. So depending on where you experience those headaches, they can tell us a little bit more as to what's going on. But I certainly agree, you know, charting and being cognizant of, you know, when you're experiencing those symptoms really tells us more about what might be going on. And gives us a better perspective of, you know, what we can do going forward.
I know one of the things that really helped me was an anti-inflammatory diet. It helped with just more than just that. But what are some of the things that women can start doing to move in a better direction, to become more balanced?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So anti-inflammatory diets, I'm a big believer of that as well too. Especially if you are elevated, your anti-inflammatory markers, or your inflammatory markers rather, are elevated. We do certainly want to implement things that are going to get those numbers down. So we know right off the bat, if you're able to, and this should be a no-brainer for most people, although it can be tricky, limiting sugar as your big way of processed sugar by that, as your biggest way of helping to tackle those elevated inflammatory markers. If you're able to do that part first, then move on to the second part. And it could be, you know, whether it's exploring food sensitivities, are you sensitive to gluten? Like, is that something that we should play around with as, you know, as being a trigger for those elevated inflammatory markers? And there's many different types of dietary protocols that can be put in place, you know, tackling inflammation per se. But I think a lot of it comes down to really tuning into your body and seeing, you know, how do you feel when you eat this food or that food? Because we know what works for, you know, one woman may not work for the next, kind of thing. So it can definitely and certainly should be, you know, tailorized to a certain degree.
I love it. By the way, removing sugar from your diet is not as easy as it may sound.
I know.
So just do the best you can, because I had an app. Yes. I took to the store and I scanned everything. And when I scanned our meat, there was sugar in ground meat. Like I was what? Like they're putting it everywhere because I don't know, we just gotten the sweet, we're the sweet tooth country and we recognize things taste better with sugar, even though it's hurting us.
Totally, totally. And within reason too, if you find that that is just, you know, stressing you out, you know, tracking sugar, the more real food and quality food that you're able to make on your own, that's a really easy way to make sure that you're trying to limit some of that added sugar within food. That's usually a big approach I take with many of my patients. If you're able to, you know, make or cook most of your food, even if it's something very simple, we already know what's in your food for the most part. So you're not getting surprised by, you know, added, you know, pounds of sugar put into, you know, your microwave dinner kind of thing.
I love it. You talk about empowerment and mentorship as well in your bio that I read in. And exactly what do you mean by that?
So empowerment and mentorship in terms of educating my female patients that I see. So I like to use education as power. So, you know, I do a good job with my patients if they know exactly the reason for why they're implementing certain treatment plans. Because, you know, it's one thing to say, you know, for example, take gluten out of your diet. It's another to actually understand the reason for why that's important for you, if it is important for you. So it's empowering women through education so that they can make the best decisions for themselves and their bodies. And you know, there's something I also say as well too, you know, there's the idea that there isn't a specialist, a doctor, or a textbook in the world that's really going to understand your body better than you. So I could tell you what the research says, but it's up to you to listen to your body to see how you respond to that. So it's that empowerment, mentorship element that I really like to include with my patients.
I love that. And I will say that you are kind of unusual because it's rare that you find a doctor who's going to explain that, right? Here's the thing. The empowerment part is you should ask, like, don't depend on them. If they say, this is what I want you to go on an anti-inflammatory diet. Why? How is that going to help me? Once you wrap your mind around something like that, it's so much easier moving forward. And I found a lot of the times I would leave my doctor's office feeling that I did not get the answers, but I realized I did not ask the questions. So I literally make a list of questions, or if he's talking, I'll write something down. And they actually have been very receptive to answering my questions and giving me what I need to read on to, instead of going to Dr. Google.
Yes.
They give me direction on what I need to read on and how I can educate myself on that situation. So it's up to us to take control of our health and ask those questions.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Because you asking questions is part of the informed consent conversation that we should be having. So there's a little acronym that we use when we engage in treatment plans with patients. It's called PARQ, the P-A-R-Q. So P is we're discussing the procedure. So what treatment plan are we implementing? A, we're talking about alternatives. So, you know, if we're prescribing or suggesting this, these are some other alternatives you could take in replace of this, you know, if you don't want to take option one. The second part, R, risk, or the third part, is talking about the risk, because we know that with any treatment that you implement, even, you know, supplements that are deemed to be natural, there's still some level of risk that we should be expecting taking those. So we need to inform patients, you know, if you take, for example, if you take B vitamins, although there's very little risk with a B vitamin, you should be aware that your urine will go neon bright yellow, and that is normal and that is to be expected. So don't panic and don't run to your ER. You know, that's, we expect that to happen. And then the Q is asking questions. So you should always feel comfortable asking questions about your treatment plan with your doctor, or else we have some problems there.
And by the way, it's always okay to, for me, it's been okay, but when my doctor wants to prescribe something, the first thing I ask him is there something holistic I can try first? And I want to do it under a doctor's supervision, right? Even when I went off, like I was on statins, I was on tons of medications, and my goal was to get off of everything. I did not do that alone. I went in and said, how do I get off these? Will you please work with me to get off these? And of course, through regular blood test and, you know, weaning me off, I was able to get off everything, which made me super happy. But I did not do that alone. I didn't say, I'm going to go off everything today.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Yeah. And I think that's a very, you know, great point to be making too. So myself as a naturopathic doctor, I commonly, you know, usually work hand in hand with a lot of family doctors as well, because I can't tell you to go off blood pressure medications, and I don't want to tell you to do that. What I want is for us to implement plans that we can support you while you work with your doctor to figure out what is the best plan in terms of your medication. So it's that idea of a collaborative approach, because when every, you know, healthcare practitioner is part of the piece and they're doing, you know, they're implementing their focus, that's where the patient gets the best outcome. You know, so I like doing diet supplements, but I want you to be in contact with your family doctor to work out the medication. And, you know, even if you are still on medications, that's still fine as well too, because as long as you're feeling your best, that really ultimately is the ultimate goal.
So, by the way, I'm so glad you brought that up, because there will be times that your doctor says, no, you cannot get this medication. So I am on one. It's a Lovenox injection I take in my stomach twice a day because I have a blood clotting disorder and I throw PEs. And so I have to take it. I know that. And I asked, is there a holistic option? And they were like, no, this is what you will be taking for the rest of your life. And that be grateful that it's just the one thing right now. And I am grateful. And we had that conversation and I'm comfortable with having to take that one thing, but they'll tell you flat out. And if it's a no, if you're feeling better, like you said, you're in a better place. Good. Just keep taking it. Sometimes you get to the point where that no is okay.
Absolutely. Yeah. And from a safety perspective too, like we want you to be in good health. And sometimes, you know, that is the number one best approach to take it. So yeah, I agree. Yeah. Yeah. No pill shaming here on my part. No. As long as you're feeling good.
Yeah, but when you're putting you on something new, it's always nice to say, I would love that. I would love to feel better. Is there something holistic I can try first? And then they can monitor you, see if it's working in the right way, and you can get off. But if you do this in collaboration with your physician and you have that communication with them, it usually turns out really well.
I agree. Yeah. Some of my best patient outcomes have come from that collaborative approach. So you're getting all the experts in their respective fields coming together and really, you know, vouching for the patient.
I love it. Dr. Gottschalk, where can people find you?
So the best way to find me would probably be through Instagram. So Dr. Allison Gotts, ND. I usually check my DMs and I'm usually flooded with DMs, but I like chatting with people that way. I also am about to launch a 12-week PCOS online program that I'm very excited about too. So, you know, if you're somebody who struggles with PCOS and you're wanting, you know, some research-based facts, you know, regarding diet, supplements, and so forth, you can find more information on my Instagram page about that and how to learn more.
Yay. We definitely want to support that. So we're going to put all the links to Dr. Gottschalk in the show notes. So go check out her 12-week PCOS program. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Go check that out. I want you guys to like go follow her on Instagram, ask her questions, be a part of that community, like start engaging. So thank you so much for being with us on the podcast today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for listening to the Oh My Health, There Is Hope podcast. Make sure to visit Jana's website, bestholisticlife.com, where you can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Google Play, or listen there so you'll never miss an episode. While you're at it, if you found value in the show, we'd appreciate a rating on iTunes. Or if you simply tell a friend about the show, that'll help too. Let's change the world together, one health expert at a time. Looking forward to seeing you next time.